Good morning, everybody. Let me first start by thanking all of you from the bottom of my heart for attending this conference. It is a special day for us. We are very excited to have all of you here. A special thanks to all the people who have come from fairly far, taken crazy flights. I know there have been crazy rains in Bombay, and all the people who have kind of weathered that and kind of taken flights and coming here. Special thanks to Shobna Mohn and Jan Kaumann, who have come from Bertelsmann, Germany, especially to give your support to the conference. Thank you very much. We're also very excited to have various leaders of the industry with us today. Pramod Sinha, Amitabh Kant, leaders who will talk about how education should be built, what policymakers are doing in this particular topic. I think it will be very exciting to hear them talk about building the next generation of education businesses. But I also want to thank all the educators who are in this room or who will join us during the day, who have probably left some of their 5th September celebrations of Teachers' Day and are coming here to attend this conference. Thank you very much. A lot of people asked us, why are we doing this conference? And I want to talk a little bit about why Bertelsmann and education, we feel that this is such a good fit. I just want to go to the next slide. I don't have a clicker. Is there a clicker? Next and back, okay. For people who are not familiar with Bertelsmann, Bertelsmann started life about 184 years back in Gütersloh as a publisher. And even today, we are the largest book publisher on the planet with Penguin Random House and DK. While we continue to be a fairly large media and services business, over the last, I would say, 7 to 8 years, we started talking about what we can do in education. Now, why was education important for us? Education was important to us because we saw three, four things happening. First of all, again, some of you know this, Bertelsmann is owned by Bertelsmann Foundation. The Mohn family took 80% of their wealth and put it in a foundation, which is controlled by the family, but it is a not-for-profit foundation. Very, very successful think tank in Europe doing a lot of work around education, and that background gives us a lot more comfort to look at sectors which are sustainable, long-term, as well as which are also doing good to the society. Of course, in our Bertelsmann businesses, we are investing and building for-profit businesses, which of course will make money, but also will do good for the world. The second reason why we got started exciting about Bertelsmann and education was because there were various adjacencies to our publishing background to the education topic, and we thought that this was a natural fitment for us to kind of move there as well. The third reason for us was, as digital, as media companies, we saw digital disrupting as well as innovating our core sectors in the 1990s and 2000s. We thought that the same will happen with education, and we want to participate in that change. With that in mind, we started making investments, both strategic and financial, in education sectors around the globe, and we have now probably invested upwards of $1 billion in the last 5-6 years, building some of these innovative education companies. We will talk a little bit about that, but they are fundamentally hosted in, if you see the last vertical over here, Bertelsmann Education Group. A lot of our strategic businesses in the education topic are hosted there. We, of course, have other investments in the education side where we are financial investors in Bertelsmann Investments Group, which is the second last in the activity. And by virtue of that, we now feel that we have investments, whether strategic or financial, in the education sector in places like the US, Europe, Brazil, China, India, and now moving into other parts of the world. In India, we started our journey in 2013 when we started investing in education assets, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Now, what is Bertelsmann Education Group? We are very, very excited that a lot of innovation is happening, and we'll talk about what we mean by innovation, at least from our perspective, in the next slide. But keeping some of the broad innovation themes in mind, we think online learning will be a very big topic for students from around the world, especially including the emerging markets. And over there, we did make investments in Relias Learning, which is online education for doctors and paramedics who want to upskill themselves while they are on the jobs. We also invested in Hotshock, a company that works with various traditional universities and colleges and get them to run online programs. See, what we fundamentally believe is disruption and innovation will not just happen in startup ecosystems. Yes, startup ecosystems in India, companies like Byju's, et cetera, are transforming how we get educated. But a lot of innovation will also happen within the universities, within colleges, within K-12 institutions. And we feel that by partnering some of those institutions, we can also be part of that or even enable that, as we have seen in the case of Hotshock. Some of our other investments are Eruditus iNurture in India, VizIQ is also in India, Udacity, which is called the University of the Silicon Valley, pioneered the concept of nano degrees. If you want to learn how to make an autonomous car, you start thinking about taking new age programs and skilling while you are in your workforce. You might be an engineer, you might be coding, but you want to learn a lot more and upgrade your skills. You go to places like Udacity and some other courses, but Udacity is really a pioneer in putting together nano degrees or smaller certificates by virtue of which you can actually become experts in the new age topics of, let's say, whether it's big data analytics, it's AI, machine learning, as well as autonomous cars, etc. We feel that is the education of tomorrow, and we want to talk a lot about it. This is, to be honest, the very first steps that we as the group have taken, especially focusing on higher education and online skilling as the first topics, where we think the rate of change and the rate of innovation and disruption would be very, very high. I had the luxury of and the privilege of joining Bertelsmann Education Group in 2010, and at that time, Pramath, we used actually McKinsey, and you were part of McKinsey at some point, to do a study of what are the large macro trends, innovation variables which will lead to such disruption. And at that time, 4 mega trends were highlighted by McKinsey to us, which we think are very true and are becoming true as we see a lot more companies coming and building businesses in the education sector. And I want to take a little bit of time talking about these trends. And I also think that we will be talking about businesses built on the back of some of these trends during the full day of conference, talking about innovation and how that is either making some of our businesses a lot more exciting or even opening new businesses for us in the education sector. The first mega trend that we want to talk about is private good is becoming a public good. Education, for the last 100, 200, 300 years, was the domain of governments, and governments would control it because that was what they were mandated to do to educate the population of their country and so on. However, the trend that we see in the West is that gross enrollment ratios, either at a primary level or at a tertiary level, are reaching much higher numbers, where the focus of government on, let's say, a tertiary education is becoming less and less. Gross enrollment ratios for tertiary education, which means students who pass 12th standard exam and move to college, that ratio is already upwards of about 60-odd% in some countries. Europe would be about 40%. China would be about 30%+. At about 40-50%, the government feels that a lot has been done. And we can start focusing on other areas of development for the nation, and education, at least tertiary education, takes a little bit of a backseat. And we've seen that when we talk to various policymakers around the world. And they are opening up education sector for private sector involvement. So that is the story of the West. We see that in the East, let's take a country like India, where gross enrollment ratio, at least when I started looking at education in 2010, used to be 10%. Now, over the last 10 years, significant improvement has happened, and now, depending on which report you read, gross enrollment ratios could be anywhere tertiary education, should be anywhere between, I would say, 20 to 25%, but it's much below what a country like ours should be at. It should be more like 30, 40%, and that is the goal of the government, to push the gross enrollment ratios to a much higher number. Now, if you were to look at brick and mortar colleges getting set up to address this gap, our Bertelsmann estimation was we would need $250 billion to build the infrastructure to do this. Government funds are not sufficient to do that, and private sector over time will have to play an active role in countries like India and China to build some infrastructure. Not all of this have to be built fully offline, to be honest, because the second trend, or actually let me talk about the third trend, is digital penetration. Today, we have about 850 million smartphone users in the country. That is massifying education to a different level. Today, there is, of course, there are some courses like medical MBBS and MD degrees where you want to have a physical infrastructure and you want to learn that offline. But blended and online is the way to go, where a lot of places where you don't need to be physically present, you can impart education from an online perspective. If you look at the OPM market in the US, that already is a $10+ billion market where various players, including Hotshot for us, have worked with various universities and colleges, and they are fundamentally helping these universities go online. We have some of the investments in our portfolio which also enable traditional institutions, whether they are K-12 institutions or they are colleges or universities, go online, and that will be a big trend. And I think together with some offline investments in schools and colleges, plus a lot of online push, can deliver the goals that we in India want to pursue of higher gross enrollment ratios of anywhere between 40 to 45%, if we even have that goal. And we would, and at some point, Mr. Amitabh Kant will be here and will talk about the new education, national education policy that is coming out, the draft has come out. We are talking to the government to give our suggestion as well, as we see ourselves as players in the international arena doing similar businesses, and that is a collaboration that we have started in India already, and we hope that this leads to great outcomes for India. But online is not just an India phenomenon, it's a global phenomenon. If you look at Udacity, it's a global business. If you look at one of our other companies, Eruditus, and we have the Eruditus founding team on the second table over here, it is a global phenomena. And how much we may want to resist it, online will be part of our business models, our businesses, and education, some of it, not all of it, will have to go online. And depending on whether you are a K-12 school, of course, we don't expect a five-year-old to learn fully online. It will be mostly offline. But there are various business models that are coming in where online is a lot more suited, especially corporate training and adult learning and colleges and universities, where this disruption will come first. And we are excited to be here in the country and also on a global basis, looking at companies and our own businesses building such innovative models. The third thing that we see, and I'm going to jump to now the second point, tech-enabled industrialization. Education used to be a lot about academics, campuses, with very little technology. However, and probably the only technology piece that college and universities would get would be learning management systems, and that itself is a fairly large industry. However, when you start talking about AI, big data, trying to understand the moods of what students like, what they don't like, talk about concepts like flipped classroom, talk about concepts like virtual classrooms, there's a lot of technology that will get into your classrooms. And we think that that will also disrupt the way education is being delivered. There will be a lot of technology through which teachers can make their curriculum better, their teaching methodology better. And at some point during the day, we will talk about personalized learning. And the engine behind personalized learning is essentially a technology layer that will enable that to happen. Flipped classroom we'll talk about at some point during the conference. I'm sure, again, technological advances coming in the classroom where education and how it is delivered will not be the same. And that is a very big mega trend globally and will be a big trend in India as well. Lastly, because of AI and big data, we feel that a lot of jobs which used to exist and still exist may not exist. The stats that I read somewhere was that our children may have to change 6 jobs in their careers, where today we are changing perhaps 1 or 2, not because of salary increments, because their skills will become obsolete. That is a real threat. And within that uncertain future of various skills, where AI and big data and analytics, machine learning will make, let's say, jobs like coding, etc., obsolete at some point, how do you build students and kids to adapt to such an uncertain future where they can be skilled and reskilled? Almost every, if your job is a, I would say, 30, 40 year career, every 5 years you're getting reskilled. That is a very daunting task. And we think that even at a K-12 level, at a school level, kids need to be taught the ability to unlearn and relearn. And that will be a very strong portion going forward, while when you become adults and you go to colleges, the ability to learn multiple skills so that if something becomes obsolete, you can still reskill yourself will be a big thing, and we'll talk more about that in the conference today as well. So given that there is so much amount of disruption happening, and the idea is not to scare you, but to actually talk about the opportunities that are in front of us, I think we are very excited to be in the education sector, to be in India, and build the next generation education businesses. In our minds, what happened to retailing when Amazon came in 1990s, and what happened to media in 1990s when large internet companies came in, similar things are starting to happen in education, with multiple variables getting played out, and we talked about some of these mega trends. And we want to start a dialogue with all the stakeholders of the ecosystem, whether it's the policymakers, the leaders who are building next generation businesses, whether it's the startups, and we will have today a lot of startups in the education system today in the conference, both as audience as well as speakers. And finally, the traditional institutions. You guys are innovating while sitting inside these K-12 institutions as well as higher ed institutions, and you must be feeling the need to innovate on some of these topics as well, and we love to hear your stories of how you're innovating within the system, not being outside the system. And I think that's exciting, and that's a reason for us to do this conference, to get all of you guys together, talk about innovation, celebrate innovation. I think we are at a cusp of a very interesting movement in this sector, and I'm very sure that 20, 30 years later, our children will not be studying the same way that we are used to studying, and we are quite psyched about it.